Hi there, Michael Lichter here for Dennis Kirk and doing another Lichter Live. I'm here back in my studio with Hawk Lachey of Vintage Technologies. Hawk came down from Kalispell, Montana, which is just 60 miles south of the Canadian border. So he knows what a long winter could be like. And thankfully, I guess due to that, we have these amazing bikes that you build.
Wow, awesome. Well, thanks for having us.
Well, it's so great you stopping in on us like this. And second time you're here in my studio, and it's so great to be here. And I'll tell you, a bike like this has so much detail that it's great to be here in my own studio where I could really crawl around from every angle. And first off, tell me a little bit about how you got your start before we get into the bike. How'd you get started with vintage technology and these bikes?
Oh man, I grew up in the automotive industry stuff with my dad and whatnot, doing Bonneville Racing and vintage car stuff, inline Chevy 6 stuff out on the Salt. And my dad built motorcycles for years, but cars were his real passion. And so I kind of was raised in the car front of things. And he passed away in 1993, at what point I inherited my Panhead, a 1953 Panhead.
And
it was in milk crates. And so it was kind of a have a motorcycle or don't have a motorcycle type of challenge. So I went through and learned the ropes on that bike. I still have it. I've been riding and wrenching on it for 29 years now. So I'm, that's my first and favorite motorcycle. But in the midst of all of it was friends getting bikes and wanting to ride bikes and trying to be part and more and more and more. And so it's just been a snowballing thing that has just been growing and growing. So yeah, since 1993, I've been building Harleys, you know, pretty religiously, so.
Well, these last number of years that I've gotten to know you through Born Free mostly. Now, how many times have you won a trip to Japan, for example?
This year's our third win with a trip to Japan to it.
And so, that's a best of show win.
Yeah. I split the best in show with Christian Newman, which is, I feel a great feat. One doesn't simply wake up in the morning and beat Christian Newman at motorcycle building. So to be on an equal playing field with him is an immense honor, and he's one of my dear friends, and I'm so excited about this next round. So,
well, your bikes have gotten crazier and crazier. I mean, the exposed valve train, all this stuff that you're doing on these bikes, and every bike you take it to a new level. So tell us a little bit about this bike, where the inspiration came from, and also like what parts of it are your favorite parts?
Well, this bike itself, I mean, I characteristically, I really like the long style choppers from the 70s and whatnot. Long bikes are kind of, I've got a sweet spot for them. And the last bike I was building with an exposed motor, no oil in it and everything, and I was catching kind of a lot of heat from different purists and whatnot about rideability and common sense and all of this other jazz that really is distracted from competitive show bike building, you know. And so in the midst of doing that, I was kind of catching a lot of heat, especially through social media, and we lost Arlen Ness, you know, one of the gods. And it really kind of, I think it really hit a lot of people. But with me personally, it was how he went about the bikes he built. He didn't really care who thought what or what. You know, none of that mattered. You know, it was continue on with his idea, put it on the ground, and then let it go from there. And as one of the pioneers, I mean, people didn't really hate his stuff. They just were force-fed to accept it, and so it was so neat. And so we kind of adopted this cooled by the tears of haters thing, and I was like, man, Arlen really helped push me through kind of a lull in my previous build that where I was really just ready to kind of change it and kind of go contemporary and make it more bland and normal or whatever. And so upon his passing, it was like, you know what, don't do that. He wouldn't have stopped doing that. Mm-hmm. So we carried on with that, and we were awarded the Arlen Ness Memorial Award from Corey and Zach at Born Free 11. So that kind of forged a neat little relationship with them. And so through some communication and whatnot, we were coming up with the design for this bike, and I wanted to do a long, like, digger drag bike type concept, because the two styles have so much in common. They're just, it's either a drag bike or it's a digger. I kind of wanted to try to throw those two things in a blender, and so this is kind of what came out of it. I got in touch with Corey, and he was able to find one of the original lowliner hardheads that was an accessory piece from the Necessity catalog in the early 70s. So it was a super neat untouched piece from their private stock. And so I kind of began the stem work of the chassis off of the neck. And I figured being a drag bike, I took and narrowed a factory 1963 pan frame another 1¾ inches and was able to graft the neck into it. Of course, I changed the down tubes a little bit to run my hydraulics for stuff. But the original down tubes were I turned into the struts of the rear suspension. So that was kind of a Arlen bent one piece, I bent the other. That was a neat thing to do. I mean, the motor mount is original, even though most of it's molded in. I mean, I tried to save everything but the actual grinder filings, you know.
What do you mean the motor mounts?
This is an original part of the motor mount that was on the frame.
Gotcha.
You know, with the kit, you would basically have a 900 Sportster. You would cut the backbone and you would cut your down tubes and you would weld one of these low liner hard head Arlen S components on, get the Arlen S fork, and now you have a digger.
Wow.
So it was a neat piece, and they made and sold millions of them, you know, or maybe not millions, I don't know the numbers. Anyways, they were very popular. Anyhow, to get one that was what I believe probably the master blank, I mean, it had never been touched and it was in the attic of Arlen S. It was in the archives, and so it was a really neat piece to get, and I wanted to make sure and use every piece of it that I could. And that kind of stemmed into the lines of the bike and gave me the digger, the low digger profile with it. And that's where it started. Then the rest of it, I knew that I just wanted a massive engine. Keeping a contemporary configuration it probably would have adhered to era correctness, but I'm a sucker for freaky engine layout. Anyway, I swapped the cylinder heads front to rear and I spun them 180 degrees so that all of the intake and exhaust was left loaded, and then incorporated a Rotax supercharger off of CD Watercraft, chain driven via the clutch pulley, and was able to get everything over on this side so that the B side of the motor had a lot of chains and busy and pipes and tubes and plumbing. But on the right side of the motor, I was able to just keep like the quintessential slab side 66 generator shovel look without being cluttered with pipes and carbs and stuff. It's just the original looks. The rocker box assemblies I handmade out of quarter plate and to expose all the rocker arms, and then took the original shovel head rocker boxes and just cut just this little sliver off of them so that I could get them on there so that I still had the venerable generator shovel head
look,
you know. I didn't want it, because without these on, and I mean, it still runs and everything, but it kind of looks like a Pratt & Whitney Wasp, like World War II airplane engine. I mean, it's really mechanical and organic, which is kind of wild, but I struggled left and right with whether I should keep these pieces on or not, but the original plan, I just kind of wanted to stick with it. And I am a Harley sucker through and through, so trying to make it doable in the late 60s, early 70s, that's what I was really going for. With the exception of the supercharger, but centrifugal superchargers are not a modern technology. They're actually, Rolls-Royce used them in the 20s, you know? So, I mean, the technology was there. It was just a good sized opportunity for me to, you know, put it into this application. So that's where that started from and stemmed from. So lots of motor and a little bike, you know? So it's not the long chopper I normally do, but.
Well, it's definitely a continuation of where you've been and taking it further. I think you so deserve that Arlen S Award that Corey presented you.
Thank you.
And do you get people that, if they know this story, they want to come over and touch the neck?
Sometimes.
I feel like there's this spirit in this.
I've caught some guys really just staring at the neck, and probably due to some of the Instagram posts that I made. Otherwise, people may or may not even notice what it is or where, you know. But yeah, the people that are tried and true Arlen S guys, like if he inspired them, this neck, I catch them checking out that certain part of the bike a lot. And the front end is actually from a friend of mine, Stanley, who has a company called the Bone Orchard, and he was a competitor with me and Christian Newman in People's Champ 5. And his People's Champ bike, he had an original Ness Century front end that was damaged. And so he had constructed all the jigs and everything to repair his front end, and in the throes of it, decided to just build a completely new front end. And to this day, he produces these front ends. So we built some of the nicest Century.
So this is a Ness inspired.
It's a Ness inspired front end, and they're so spot on, you know, and he adds in his production models, there's grease zerts, and they're very, very utilitarian. Well, I got a hold of him and I explained, well, I need one narrower. So he got one almost a full inch narrower than a conventional Century. And he did the right, the low band with it and whatnot, put the rockers on the inside and Frenched all the hardware to keep it nice and clean. And so he was able to work with me and get me something that was...
It's gorgeous.
It's a Century, but they never made one that tiny, you know. So it was a gorgeous. Very neat piece to be able to work with a friend of mine, and he was totally into the project. So
I didn't realize he was doing that, because I bugged Corey for a number of years that he needs to get these front ends out, so now I know they're available.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I didn't realize what the background was, but in the bends in there, I did a detail. It was so sexy. I mean, it's just so perfect. And there's a number of things here. The struts on the back end there, I didn't realize they came off
Were, and the lower portion of them is actually the kickstand lug off of the Ironhead Sportster.
Yeah, you know, I did a detail just of that because it was so pretty. I mean, everything is
That's the kickstand off of Sportster.
That's so cool. Yeah. It's so organic. But also, like your chain, that's a Hawk Lachey little touch.
I have been able to get away with welding my chains. I've had a lot of guys hit me up for it, and then I kind of explained to them time frame and cost and stuff. Right. And again, it's not something that I wouldn't do for somebody. You know, I've never really tested them in an extreme situation, but...
But the time involved.
It came from a bike we were doing, my red knucklehead, where we were trying to hide every rivet.
It was gorgeous.
And one of the guys in the shop says, well, what about all the rivets in the chain? Yeah. What about these little pins? I'm like, oh man. So after a couple chuckles, I was sitting around the TIG welder welding chains. So it seems like a neat trait we've been able to carry on from bike to bike. And I had never done any in gold. And so with three chains on this bike with a gold theme, I'm like, wow, these chains are going to really talk to us. And when I took them out of the box from the plater, I was blown away.
It's a trademark feature. The open rockers, is that something you've done, a couple times now?
I've done it a couple of times now. I mean, this is really just derived from... early knucklehead stuff and the guys that were building the early
eight valves,
overhead valve conversions and stuff, Coslows and whatnot. I mean, they're just grease zerts and it's all you really need, you know? And so, although highly impractical, I've never had a system fail with them. I mean, if you add grease and you run them and you run them up and down the road and whatnot, and that's not the part that gets hot. It's usually where I'm the guy that will chop all of the cooling fins off a cylinder so I can see the cylinder a little better. So that's the problem I usually run into is just heat. But
I'll tell you, I crawled around this thing and even on the ground looking up at some of your brackets and things, just spectacular. I got to congratulate you and let everybody know that there'll be a full feature on this bike in Easy Riders.
Oh,
and,
fantastic.
This will appear on the Dennis Kirk blog. And I'm looking forward to shooting many more of your bikes in the years to come. And hopefully I'll get to your shop because... I want to see your shop.
You got to come see us. We got to come see us. Michael, thanks for everything. Absolutely.
Oh, man. Hawk, thanks for being here. Thanks for bringing your bikes.
Oh, my pleasure as always.
All right. Thanks for tuning in.